study that analyzed the social patterns of more than 2,500 mammalian species found that 68% are solitary, 9% monogamous, and 23% live in higher social organizations. The research speculates that the original pattern, still practiced by two-thirds of mammals, is solitary living and meeting only for the purpose of mating. This is true, for example, for these leopards here. Both males and females defend the territory. Females defend territories that have prey and burrows for hiding young ones against other females. Males defend a territory that has females against other males. Male territories are bigger and overlap that of several females. The authors suggest that monogamy evolved when males could not defend more than one female in her territory. An example for such monogamy is this diktik, a small antelope that lives in monogamous couples in a shared territory. About a quarter of the studied mammalian species live in a complex social structure with several males and/or females. Such structures prevail in large mammals that we will discuss now. A harem is a structure where one male dominates several females. Hippos are one of the largest mammals. Males can reach the weight of 3 tons, while females usually reach half this weight. To learn about hippos, we especially came to here, to the Zambezi, the border between Zimbabwe on that side and Zambia on this side. And we came to a lodge which is called Mvu, which means hippo in the local language. And we will take a boat and travel along the Zambezi to see all the hippos from the side of the river, which is the correct size of seeing them, because they're most of the time either in the water or on the banks. Hippos are widely considered to be the most dangerous African animal. They are not necessarily aggressive, however, when they are afraid that their access to the water is blocked, they can reach a top speed of 40 km per hour and will trample everything on their way. It is a bit odd that they feel so unsafe, as they lack any natural enemies. Their anxiety is demonstrated here in a funny way. When we approached them with our boat, while they were basking in the sun on the bank, they rapidly rushed to the water. This was in spite of the fact that the presumed danger came from the water. Hippos feed on grass that they usually eat at night on the banks of the river. We had a rather scary night in Uganda when hippos roamed around our tent cutting grass. Hippos don't usually attack tents, but still it was a bit unnerving to have a herd of these biggies shielded only by a thin plastic sheet. Here we see a mother and baby hippo feeding at night. The male is highly territorial. Here we see a male marking his territory by spreading his dung all over with his small tail. Here's another such example. These yawns, by which he is presenting his formidable tasks, are also a territorial signal. These sharp teeth are not for feeding, but they serve as protection against predators and for fighting other males. You might find it hard to believe that hippos can't swim. They walk on the bottom of the river or lake. Their eyes, ears and nostrils are all on the top of their head, so they can breathe, see and hear while fully submerged in the water. Staying in the water saves a lot of energy and helps thermoregulation. Animals that live in a harem are sexually dimorphic, and indeed the hippo male is twice as big as the female. A single male dominates up to 80 females. Hi, I'm here at the Año Nuevo Beach in California. I mean, this course is called Sex from Molecules to Elephants, but we went all the way to California to see here the elephant seals. So what you can see here behind me is the elephant seal colony. This time of the year are molting, so they're changing their fur and their skin, and you mainly see here males, big males. And when they come out of the sea, they're maybe 2.5 tons, they're huge, but they lose up to half of their weight when they're on the beach because they're not eating. Here we can see some of the small ones, which are maybe yearlings, and they come up to the beach as well. After molting, the males return to the ocean. They will arrive again in November and establish territories by posing and fighting. The pregnant females arrive next and cluster in harems of dozens of females. They give birth to pups whom they nurse for a month with milk that contains up to 50% fat, more than 10 times that of human or cow milk. After that, they mate with the alpha male and occasionally with his beta male helper. The females return to sea, leaving the pups that have almost tripled their weight to fend for themselves. They are exhausted from giving birth, from lactating, and mainly from the month without food on the beach. The pregnancy is thus delayed, and the embryo will start to develop only after returning to the ocean, feeding, and recovering their body weight. These are the celebrity Californian sea lions that have settled for unknown reasons on Pier 39 in San Francisco. They have a different strategy. Males establish a territory, and the females roam between them and choose with whom to mate. This is similar to the legs we described in some bird species. As both the birth and mating take place on the beach, the females time them by delaying the development of the embryo, like the sea elephants. After giving birth, the mothers stay a few days with their newborn babies. Subsequently, they go to hunt at sea, returning to feed their babies every few days. Mothers and babies identify each other by their voice. Here, we see the Cape Cross fur seal colony in Namibia. Fur seals are related to sea lions and they lead a similar life and reproductive cycle. We arrived here shortly after the mothers gave birth. Here is a newborn still connected by its umbilical cord to its placenta. The final marine species we will see are harbor seals. We know very little about their reproduction as they mate at sea. They therefore have neither territories nor harems. They too give birth on land. Let us now return to Africa. In the savanna here, there are many species of ungulates that feed on grass and that have a wide range of social systems. We will mention three examples: impalas, wildebeest, and zebras. Two central aspects of sociality are hierarchy and territory. Animals that live in groups form a social ranking. For males, this ranking affects their chance to mate with females. The more senior the male, the more offspring he will sire. Sometimes most of the population are progeny of very few males. Due to the seasonal availability of food and water, many herbivores do not maintain territories throughout most of the year. Predators like lions and leopards, in contrast, defend large permanent territories. Impalas are one of the most widespread and successful antelope. Large herds of impalas can be found in most reserves in southern and eastern Africa. During the mating season, the strongest males occupy territories and mate with females that pass through them. When male fawns mature, they are expelled from the female herd and join a male herd. In this herd, they gradually raise in their ranking that is established by frequent sparring, as we see here. Only when they achieve the top rank, they are ready to take over a territory that will enable them to mate. One of the reasons for the success of impalas is that all females give birth within a few weeks, so that all of a sudden there is a huge number of fawns. Many of them, of course, will get eaten, but many survive. Wildebeest, also called gnu, are well known for their mass migrations in eastern Africa and Zambia. Wildebeest males also keep a territory during the mating season. As they usually move in large herds that protect them from predation, defending a territory makes them very vulnerable to predators. However, as only males that have a territory will be able to mate, this risk is vital for reproduction. Mating is synchronized so that fawns will be born in the wet season that is rich in green grass. We will conclude with these beautiful zebras. Zebras live in large herds that are comprised of families composed of 4 to 6 mares dominated by a single stallion, like a harem. When a filly enters estrus for the first time at about 15 months of age, this attracts the stallions in the environment that try to abduct her. For young bachelor stallions, this will be the first mare in their family. Older stallions that have already mares will try to abduct her to enlarge their family. The filly might get abducted several times until she will become a permanent member of her family. When this happens and she will get pregnant, she will remain with this family for her entire life. mares give birth once a year for about 20 years. Shortly after giving birth, a mare enters estrus and pregnancy lasts for about a year. The violent abduction might be required to prevent inbreeding. If the filly would have stayed with her family, she might have been impregnated by her father. Foals have a strong and friendly bond with their father. They too, however, leave the family and join a herd of young stallions. They will remain in this herd until they are mature and strong enough to abduct mares and start a family. The mares in the family have a clear ranking. The first filly the stallion abducted will become the senior mare. She will lead the marching single file, and all other mares will follow in the order of their ranking. The male is the most senior member, and he walks behind or beside the group and protects it. Zebras help and protect young, old or sick individuals, and stallions have very friendly relationships. Multiple cases have been witnessed where zebras protected individuals attacked by predators and saved them. I brought you this complex story to show how intricate and fascinating zebra sociality is. Something hard to imagine when watching huge herds of them in the savannah. There are plenty of other mammals and forms of sociality we couldn't discuss here, but I hope I have triggered your curiosity to continue the quest on your own.